and how it fits with knowledge. Two apparently parallel but distinct areas that I think it's time to put together. And I think if we put them together, we can make a very powerful future of knowledge. I'm probably stating the obvious here to this group, but today's online documents are kind of lifeless, inactive, and flat. They're kind of what you do if you take paper and you put it on a computer. They're not what you do if you take what was originally a computer and start afresh, I would say from a blank sheet of paper, to redesign what one would set up as one's knowledge container. So let's just see how that manifests itself in different places. Scientific papers. You know, where's the data? We've heard, obviously, different takes on how to connect things up. What are the algorithms? Why aren't they contained within documents or with ready to run? How do I rerun the code? Typical problems that actually have real disasters associated with them, where people misunderstand things and miscommunicate. Business presentations. You know, people make decisions on billions of pounds worth based on assumptions they can't test. Executives don't know what they're looking at. They can't actually ask what-if questions there and then. You know, these things are typical examples of where we've got dead knowledge, so to speak, presented to people. Textbooks. You know, why do we have particularly technical textbooks, STEM textbooks and things, that don't allow people to explore ideas? You know, don't allow people to drive, get intuition. These are common problems that perhaps I've conceptualized slightly differently, but I think everyone would agree are things we could move way forward on. So what we've been trying to do is figure out how do we make documents come alive with the power of computation? What can we do to achieve that? And I guess the way I look at this is to think of a communication pipeline between authors and readers. Right now, we have an author who's essentially having to compress down their information to a really, really narrow pipe that is our current static document. And then at the other end, the reader's kind of trying to expand this out to figure out what the hell the author was really trying to say. There's no way of, and there's very little interaction back and forth. So the question is, how can you really broaden that pipe? Because, you know, in the modern world, I mean, when you had printing presses and stuff with, you know, paper and things, there was a reason to have a narrow pipe. There is no reason now. The pipe can be really wide. We have big computation, you know, good communications. So here's an example of what I mean. I guess for any of the chemists and things here, this is a pretty obvious diagram of a gas bouncing around in a box. Okay. It's an actual thing right here in a document. It's working. I can play with it. I can increase the number of atoms. It's actually doing the simulation. I can look at some theoretical value. You know, the code is right here. So, you know, these things are, in this case, rather longer code than probably it ought to be. Anyway, these are, you know, that's an example of what I call a knowledge app, a sort of combination of computation and documents put together. Well, so one of the things we've been doing is to try and take that idea and generalize it to a thing which we're calling computable document format. And the idea is to basically be able to, you know, to have computation apps, if you like, different ways of thinking about it, mixed in with the static document. So let me try and go to my browser here and show you what I mean. So this is some examples of, it decided to log me out. Can somebody just tell me it's actually got it here. Let's see if it, yes, I'm online. Fantastic. Good news. Now let me go back to where I was. And, So hopefully, well, of course, this is what happens if you don't have everything offline, you see. Let's see. Why won't it, there we go. We're getting there, okay. So the thing I wanted to show was, you know, here are some actual examples of CDFs, which, if you like, are a generalization of what I was just saying. So here's an example that basically was a sort of, I don't know, mixture of an academic paper and a consulting report. And I'll just show you in here, but I'll actually fire up the real document. This was used to argue the case for changing hurricane insurance in Texas. And it was actually, you know, used, so to speak, to, and I'm going to actually, this is obviously in situ in the browser, but I'm going to load the the fuller document, because I think for this case it's rather easier to look at it as a fuller document. It's assuming we can get there quickly. Okay, so this is, you know, the document was that. It looks kind of like a traditional paper, you know. It's got some structure and it's got different things. But then right bang in the middle here, I can go and change the actual assumptions I'm making. I can go and do a real calculation. You know, it's actually working out. And potentially I could be trying a calculation here that's fresh. Nobody may have set the parameters as I've set them or put in the calculation. So we're doing live stuff here, and I want to come back to that theme. So that's one kind of thing one might do. You know, again, talking of corporate things, it's amazing that we all get pension statements that are dead. You can't actually try any assumptions in them. This is nuts, okay? You know, we should be pushing for things that actually work. You know, the other interesting thing is sort of, what I would call infographics and blogs. You know, the fact that you can have, if you're talking about earthquakes in Japan or whatever, that you can actually have something to play with, a real thing here that's been done. That should be an assumed part of communicating what's happened with, you know, with an earthquake. And, you know, how do the shock waves actually go? What actually happens here? Actually looking at it. You know, this is so much more descriptive than what you see in a traditional paper. So those are a few examples that I just wanted to highlight there. So what do I think are the key characteristics for future knowledge containers, as I call them? One thing is important. It has to be, a great thing about documents is they're very everyday. And that's not true of traditional apps right now. Most people don't build an app every day, but they do make documents every day. So that's a gap that has to be kind of closed. And also, you know, there are still advantages of offline and online. We've got to have both, and it's kind of important to have both of those neatly put together. We've heard, you know, key reasons why we have online, and absolutely those are valid. But also, you know, it's not, you can't just have one or the other. Important, I'll come back to, easy to author interactivity. You know, that comes along with the everyday document. It's no good if it's so hard to make the thing that nobody bothers. And part of that game is it's no good just pre-generating content, you know, which is kind of like a slideshow or something, or equivalent pre-generated videos or whatever. That's fine for certain things, but you really need content actually generated, you know, which can be live generated by the person reading, in quotes, playing. Because otherwise you can't do new things. They can't try new things that they might want to. So that's a key point I want to pick up. That's what I call interactive versus interactive. The pre-generated versus the sort of computational. And I guess one, you know, there are various ways to, analogies one can use for this, I guess. I think of a landscape of knowledge, and I think of the difference between a railway line and sort of renting a four-wheel drive vehicle. You know, if you have a railway line, somebody's taken you down a particular path, and that's kind of, you can go backwards and forwards, you might be able to go faster or slower, maybe there are some branch lines if you're lucky, but that's the path you're on. The question is, can we generate a nice future of knowledge where there's effectively a whole terrain you can explore, you can go pretty much wherever you want. Maybe the author has put in certain boundaries that, you know, they're trying to direct you, like roads, but you can go off road as well. And that's, I guess, what I think of as computational interactivity as opposed to kind of pre-generated interactivity. So I think the technical ingredients for achieving this are, number one, top of the tree, is automating things. You know, we've spent 25 years trying to automate computation and other things. It's really critical that there are layers of automation between what you actually want to achieve and the mechanics of how to achieve it. And obviously you need computational power underneath to do the things you want to do. You also need, you know, symbolic documents, things that are represented where you can actually operate on the document in a symbolic way. And obviously one needs to be able to fit for scientific audience. You know, one wants actual things that, you know, work from the math, so to speak. That's a sort of important thing. So one needs to link the, you know, the semantics has to be in there, so to speak, to link to the typesetting. So that's a very important, you know, part of that. The idea of symbolic documents, everything is one kind of object, gives tremendous power to this computational approach. And what I really want to come onto is the interface. What is the interface, you know, both sort of to interact as a reader and also to author? So I thought I would live dangerously here and actually try and build a little app, sort of interactive app, and I thought I would just set myself up with this. So there's a typical, you know, piece of physics or something, beats, I guess people would say. Now the question is, can I make a sort of more interactive version of this? And again, this is what I mean by, you know, this is our particular way of doing it, but I think the principle is the same, whatever you're, however you're doing it, whatever system one might choose. That you want to have a layer of automation here. So, you know, in our case, we have a thing, manipulate, that allows us to, you know, let's say go from, you know, change a parameter and put the parameter in this thing immediately. So it's figuring out what do you do about how to lay it out. You know, what does it do on different platforms? You know, how is the computation going to be wired to the actual thing? And there we go. There's an actual, you know, little piece of app, if you like, built in a few seconds. So that ease of authoring is critical to getting people to adopt real things that are interactive. And I think, you know, we've got to, and I'll say more about how to improve that. Now, another thing that's also important is, hi, here I am, actual live things, you know, documents that support live stuff happening, data you're actually running with at the moment, in this case, image data, video data. So again, you know, can I do something cool here? Can I actually, you know, let's see, an edge detect or something. And, you know, can we actually, let's put a parameter in here, I think. So there we've done an edge detect. We can actually do stuff. Can we build an application live while we're doing this? You know, I'm going to do the same kind of thing again. Let's put a parameter, let's put an effect or something in here. And let's see if, it's always good to live dangerously. It's always much harder to do this in front of an audience than when one's by oneself. But let's say we want to blur or something, and maybe we'll put a parameter in, let's say, n goes from, let's say, a 0 to 10. Let's hope I haven't messed this up. Let's put the n in there instead of 5. Okay, well, we have something there that's, let's try and blur instead. Okay, yeah, so it seems to be working here, I think. I may have put that parameter in the wrong place. But anyway, there we go. So my point is that you want actual real data that can operate and go into documents. That's a key part of, you know, the scientific process. Take your own data, work with it, actually make it work, have the algorithms there ready to run. Be easy enough to adjust things that you can kind of do that. That's sort of a key part of what I think one needs. Now, is this easy enough for everyone? What I just did with writing some code and things, can everyone do that? Well, I actually think a lot of the scientific technical community can do that themselves as individuals. But I don't think that's easy enough yet. But let me show you one of the things we've had running for some time, which I think is an interesting sort of experiment in if you like, interactivity publishing. So there's a thing called the Demonstrations Project, which as of today has 7,525 demonstrations posted on it. These are mostly posted, you know, by the community. They are not mostly ours. And so it's kind of, you know, nice that people have been able to make things like this sufficiently easily that they can post them on a site like this. That's a kind of a litmus test here. As far as I know, this is the largest what I would call knowledge app site in the world, where, you know, you're mixing knowledge with apps. And the fact that these things just sit here and, you know, we get many of them submitted every day is kind of an interesting testament to, you know, being able to author. You know, that is the blockage in traditional interactivity and is authoring, you know, and the fact that one can author these things fairly easily and one gets these very rich results is interesting. But as I say, we're not completely satisfied yet with where this authoring is. I think, you know, what we really want is everyone to do authoring every day of the week and for that to be a kind of easy thing. And I think a key answer to this is what I would call linguistics. And in a sense, you know, Wolfram Alpha is an example of using linguistics to access data. And another use of linguistics is to kind of operate things, if you like. So I can try and take that earlier thing that I tried to make, and I could say something like manipulate, you know, sine x plus sine ax, for example. We'll see what happens with that. My point is I'm trying to write in a piece of text, a piece of linguistics, something that's sloppy, it's not syntactically right, you know, it's a mess. And I'm trying to get that turned into something that is code. And that interface between those two is really important for the future, because that's what allows you to be able to command quite complicated code building, or at least get started with it with minimal effort. And I mean, you know, in this case, we got something, you know, pretty close to what I wanted. But in fact, you know, I might go in and edit the code, for example. I didn't really want it between minus six and, you know, whatever. The point is, the fact that the code has largely been built for me makes it much easier for me as an author to go figure out what to do, and brings that authoring one level easier than it than sort of coding would be. How did we get into this at all? People associate us as a place that does, you know, does computation. But as I mentioned, one of the things we've done is automation. And so we built Mathematica in 88. We launched Wolfram Alpha in 2009. And the launch of CDF was just a couple of months ago. And one of the nice things for us is we've had experience with, you know, millions of people around the world being able to build some of these things that you didn't know they were CDFs, but they can now sort of able to author with those. And so we've got some experience of how to do that and what's happening. And it's very interesting to see what's sort of emerging in that area. I wanted to switch gear a little bit and talk about the bigger picture, perhaps, of, you know, how I see the future of knowledge and computational knowledge and so forth. You know, one thing is clear to me that, and that's come out in some of the talks I heard earlier, you know, the value of what you might call, what I'm going to call computational knowledge is much greater than dead information. And it doesn't matter what kind of business of knowledge you're in, whether you're in the media or whether you're in scientific publishing or whatever. You know, dead information is going to go down in value. No question about it. I mean, if you want an example of where this has kind of happened, look at maps. You know, maps that actually work with a sat nav are much more valuable than maps you open out on paper. And that value of the paper side has gone down, and, you know, the value of the sat nav side has gone kind of up. And, you know, there are always competitive pressures on open sourcing and so forth. That's as it is. So I would also argue that computational is kind of a level beyond, I suppose I'd argue, semantic. I think semantic doesn't necessarily tell me you can compute results automatically from it. It tells me there's a certain body of information that tells you more than just stuff that wasn't semantic, but it doesn't necessarily mean you can actually do stuff from it. If you look at the inside of Wolfram Alpha as an example, you know, semantic stuff isn't good enough. We've got to make it computational, and that's several steps beyond semantic. So I think when one's looking at information one has, one needs to think of making it computational for it to, you know, gain the kind of value level that one would probably want for it. Let's talk about knowledge assets that different folks have. And, you know, I just want to spend a couple of minutes just walking through these. You know, people who have lots of knowledge assets, obviously governments. Well, one of the problems with governments, you know, they have, they have their own data. They have huge amounts of data. One of the things I've often been telling governments is, if you want to become more efficient, get your data in a form that you can actually work with it from. Because you, the government, at this moment, are the people who most use government data. So if you can actually access your own data better, you might become more efficient. You know, it seems obvious, but you know, that's sort of the way. And again, you see with governments, one interesting thing, you know, there are things like the open data initiatives. There's a big difference between dumping a bunch of data out and democratizing it. Democratizing means that, you know, your average person go use the data in some meaningful way. Dumping a bunch of, you know, spreadsheets out or something isn't that. In fact, I remember being at The Guardian one day when the government had done one of their, you know, things out onto data.gov or whatever it was. And there were, you know, 15 people in the room, all with computers, experienced journalists, trying to figure out what the hell they could figure out from this data. Okay, that isn't democratized. It may be better, it's certainly a lot better than not releasing it, but it's not democratized. So there's a big gap, and I think people often underestimate the gap between those two. If you get the data form right to start with, you're in much better shape. Whoops. Publicly funded R&D, and of course, scientific publishing that goes along with that. You know, I don't know what we spend a year around the world, $300-400 billion on sort of what I would count as government-funded research and development. That's a lot of money to get a bunch of dead papers out from. I'm being provocative, but basically, you know, one should be arguing for stuff that works, as I was. You know, you don't want climate gates where people have lots of opportunities. Similarly, you know, the data didn't really fit here. You want to be able to go play with it yourself and see whether you agree or don't agree. Rerun things directly from it. Don't rebuild it. That should be part of the publishing process. And of course, along with that comes a lot of issues about, you know, what in software we call quality assurance and what you call, you know, editorial process and other things. Often. It's a different process. It's very related. And it's been interesting to see with our demonstration site how that process tends to pan out. Another thing, corporate information. I think all of us in organizations know that our internal information is frankly a mess. As in, you know, if I want to ask what is you know, John's sales incentive for last quarter by typing it in, I can't do that. I have to go to some report that tells me probably stuff I didn't really want to know about something completely different from which I manually compute some result about that answer. That's not a good situation, and we can fix it. And the other thing I want to talk about is human experts. So people sometimes say to me, if you take a thing like Wolfram Alpha, where you are encoding in, so expertise. So, you know, if I go to let's flick to that just in case, you know, just to give an example. If I say, see if it knows highest building in London or something. Actually, let's do Apple versus Microsoft. Always a good one. Maybe I should have picked some of the companies here, but I've got an experimental version that I wasn't supposed to have. But anyway, there we go. So here's the point I want to make. So there we have a bunch of, you know, information that came out about Apple versus Microsoft, and it's all a bit slow because I've got the wrong version. But how Apple's market cap went way up and everything, and you can look, in fact, at the history of that rather nicely. And this all comes straight out. This document that I'm showing you was computed live right now. So what happened was it understood linguistically what I was doing here. It interpreted that, turned it into symbolic expression. From the other end, it had a whole bunch of data, including pulling data feeds, that was symbolically, you know, put into a symbolic form. And then it computed between the two. It did that on some servers. It then built a document automatically, a CDF, in fact, in this case. That's the new experimental feature that I didn't know I had installed on this machine. It built a CDF, and it then produced and put out the CDF, and that's what we have right here. So that document was built live. You know, probably somebody's asked this particular question before, but I could have asked a question that nobody had ever asked before, and it was a live answer that came. Now, the point I want to also say about human experts is this. People say to me, you know, effectively you're encoding a bunch of expertise. Does this reduce the role of human experts? And the answer is no, absolutely not. I would say it gives a huge megaphone to human experts in the sense that, you know, we have to figure out, you know, what are the set of parameters? There are hundreds of parameters you could look at. What's the right set that you actually want to have here? And if you look here, you know, we've picked out a particular set of things. So that kind of editorial process is very important. And that needs sort of human expertise to make it work.
About 3 minutes.
Right. Okay, I just wanted to make my little thing about changing education that was mentioned by David at the beginning. I'm saying you should make computers very automated, very easy, so everyone can kind of get the stuff to happen immediately. But I also think, paradoxically perhaps, that we should fundamentally change our math and science education. And I think we should do it and re-educate people based on the idea that computers are around and are there and are not going away. What does that mean? That means that, you know, it's 80% or so of our math education, it consists of teaching people how to hand calculate things. And nobody really does that outside, except in some edge cases. And yet around the world, my reckoning is 103 average world lifetimes are spent per day learning hand calculating. So we better be damn sure there's a reason for this. And I don't really think there is. I think you could do much better, get people much, much further in their mathematical understanding and problem solving and things that really are needed for all the STEM subjects if you assume computers do the calculating and push on the other steps that are more conceptual. Complicated argument, you know, my TED talk and other things that we have a lot. So we have a thing called computerbasedmath.org where we are leading that campaign to try and change the world's maths education, depending where you come from, to make it computer-based. And I think we're getting very good traction for that. It's a direction, a radical direction I think people haven't quite assimilated before now. So look, I think I wanted to end by just saying, you know, don't compress the idea, expand the medium. That was the main pitch. We have a great ability to expand the medium now. And it's interesting, one of the things that goes along with that is when expression, so to speak, gets personal. And I just wanted to bring up this chart. You know, the history of sort of documents and knowledge is where people themselves who have the knowledge can themselves produce the output. You know, word processing, tech, of course, a major contributor to that process. Desktop publishing, where the individual gets empowered to do it. And that lowers authoring costs a great deal and means you can get much richer content. And that's sort of what we're trying to do with CDF. And of course, one has to make sure everything is computable. So hopefully we achieved that rather than, I guess I have to find the right slide. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you very much, Conrad. I think we have time for one question while we're swapping the computers out for the next session.
Good morning, Richard Wynn from Aries Systems. Thank you for a lovely presentation. If you ask most of the publishers in this room, primary publishers, how they make their money or what the value is that they add, they'll tell you it's peer review. And I think one of your comments was there's no reason to have a narrow pipeline. And the journal Neuroscience last year, the editor-in-chief announced that they would stop accepting data sets during peer review because of the burden on reviewers. And so I wonder how you see the impact on peer review here.
I think peer review, I mean, look, the idea that you've got to kind of, okay, so one question is, it's sort of a branding question in a sense in the end. Do you believe that there's a particular brand of journal or whatever that is worked out enough and people have looked at that it kind of doesn't waste your time? You know, you don't have to just page through lots of stuff that wasn't really figured out. So I think that value is still very much important. The process of it, I think, changes. Because, you know, saying that, well, sorry, we can't handle data seems like the wrong way around. I mean, it's like, fix your system, fix your process so that you can handle it. And, you know, just like software people have to go figure out how to make software that works, hopefully. And they have a bunch of processes and quality assurance ways to do that. Some of that's kind of peer review. Some of that's technical. You know, does the piece of software actually function? So I think strongly that the idea of editorialization is critical still, and peer review or a process similar to that, but that the mechanisms have to evolve and get more sophisticated to allow this breadth of information that I'm talking about.
Okay, thanks again, and thanks to all the speakers in this session for a very interesting and informative set of talks. Oh, I'm supposed to mention sponsors and evaluation forms as well.